How many people would be here if Jeremy Kent really was worshiping here? You know, when I was worshiping, all I could think of, not all I could think of, when I was totally, it was blowing my mind that, you know, me and Melissa haven't been talking about the message or anything. We had all the songs that we were just singing are, I'm just blown away how God works that out. Because, not intentionally, but the message does talk a lot this morning. The Lord does speak to suffering and, you know, no more tears, no more, all of that good stuff, you know. It's just amazing how you see God, the Holy Spirit, move like that and puts everybody on the same page. It's so sweet. And it just encouraged me because I was like, I really want to see like a whole bunch of people here. And but it doesn't matter. I was thinking, if you ask every American right now that goes to church, if you ask them, let's say you showed up to church and the pastor said, next Sunday, we are losing our building, so we're going to have church and worship outside in the parking lot. And we don't have our sound equipment. We lost that. It's all been repoed by the IRS, whatever, right? Just imagine that. Everything in your church has been taken away, and the only thing that you have is what you can bring, which is this, the Word of God. And you're the body of Christ, and then dwelling in you is the Holy Spirit. But I wonder how many Americans would still come and gather if they didn't have the coffee, if they didn't have the awesome bands playing up front, if they didn't have a building that was nice and warm and convenient and comfy, you know? If you've ever been on a mission trip, it's amazing because you know who the Americans are in the group when we're in Mexico and there's like a small room and everybody's packed in there and everyone's like sweating all over each other, you know what I mean? It's just, and I'm just like, oh, we're so uncomfortable. It's just because we're weak Americans, you know? We're not used to walking miles to church or, you know, it's so simple for us, you know, to wake up this morning and say, you know what? Maybe I don't need to go to church because I don't want to expose myself to COVID-19, you know? And it's like, this isn't a trip about not coming to church, but it really is, though, a check on where's your heart? Because if you are going to church, ask yourself, would you go to church if those things didn't exist? And if the answer is no, then wherever you're going to church probably isn't where you should be going to church. Because the only reason why we come together is for this. And this happens whether we have sound, whether we don't. And it's for this, the fellowship that we have, you know, with one another. And the Holy Spirit that wants to interact in between the body of Christ. Like, you sharing with me what God's been doing in your devotional life. Or me sharing with you what God's doing in my life. Because we can rejoice no matter what's going on in my life. You can always find someone else's life, even if you think that maybe your eyes are on yourself, right? We do that as believers sometimes. My eyes can be on myself and, oh, poor me. And then you can talk to one of your believer friends and you see God doing an amazing work in their life. And yes, God's doing one in your life too, but maybe you just don't see it, you know? But what's so amazing is you can always see God working, whether it's in your life or in the life of your brothers and sisters in Christ. And it's just awesome. That's why we have to come together, because we're to encourage one another in this. And if there's ever a time that we need encouragement, probably would be now. I think most believers are encouraged by seeing what's taking place, because you know, our problem is sometimes we forget to give God the little things, right? I could do this, I could do that, and I don't give God the little things. But when it comes to this, you know, COVID-19 or whatever, who can control it? Who's going to manage it? You know, who's going to save the world? You know, it's Jesus, you know? It's all about Jesus. It's not about anything else. And we already know that. You know, if you're born again and Jesus is the center of your life, you wake up in the morning, he's the first thing on your mind, and he's the last thing on your mind when you go to bed, and you're having fellowship with him throughout the day, you're encouraged because you know he's in control. And you have a God that loves you. And it's just amazing how that works, how we're encouraged, even though things might appear bad, right? That's what's amazing about the Holy Spirit in our lives. It's not just, I think sometimes we talk about only what it's going to be like in heaven, you know? And that's amazing. I feel like even talking about heaven is like devaluing it because you can't say enough about what heaven's going to be. But also, it's about what's going on in this life. No matter what cards you've been dealt, no matter how old you are, or whether you have cancer, or one arm, or there's a lot of bad things, diseases, whatever. But we're going to get into the Word anyways with all that. I just wanted to, let's just pray. Dear Lord, no more Colby stuff. I just want to pray this morning, Lord, that through your Word, God, this morning you would speak to me and to those with me. God, speak to those that watch online and those that maybe were sick. I pray probably my mom and dad are at home watching. Just bless my dad, Lord. I do lift him up. God, I pray you touch his body. Heal his insides, God. That give him strength back. And Lord, anyone that's suffering in the body of Christ, we just pray for them now, Lord. God, just pray for those that are sick, for those that are struggling emotionally, whether it's physical, emotional, God and Lord, mostly we pray that God's spiritual. So many in this world are struggling spiritually, God. They don't know you, or they do know you, God, and they haven't been walking with you. And so, God, we just lift up the body of Christ. We lift up our neighbors, our friends, our family. And Lord, we just pray that this morning you would impact our lives, God, as we know that's where the revival happens, in each individual person. And as we go and live our lives, God, that you're going to use us in everything that we do, God, that we will glorify you, we will reflect you. And even when we think we're the dirtiest or the weakest or messing up the most, even when some of the world looks at us and thinks we're fools, God, the light of Christ is in us. And that is the light that can change lives. And that's what we pray, Father, that while we're still here, while we still have day left, we glorify you, God, that we would bring as many with us as possible, that you would give us that love in our heart to love others, God, when we shouldn't be loving them, but it's only your love. When we don't want to love them, but it's your love. When sometimes we don't even know how to love, but God, you give us all of those things. Put those things in our heart, God, that we would love people, and that we would shine a light, Lord, lead them to you, God. I mean, after all, you've done all this work. You went to the cross. It's a lot of work, what you did to give your life to make this way, that we can have salvation. And to think that all that work that you've done, Lord, all that suffering and everything you did would be missed, God. That somebody wouldn't receive it. That they would rather choose to spend the rest of their eternity apart from you in suffering, Lord. So we pray for them, Lord, that don't know you, God. Pray that they'll come to me this morning. I pray that you touch their hearts and you speak to them through this message. And those of us that do know you, Lord, speak to us, lift us up, encourage us, convict us, Lord, with your double-edged sword, God, deep down into the bone, the marrow, into our soul. Draw us closer to you, God. Open our eyes, Lord. Open our hearts. Forgive us for our sin. Fill us with your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. I thought we were just going to have a prayer meeting there for a moment and just keep going. it's so awesome that what the riches that we have in Christ, prayer, worship, the Word. All right, so we're in chapter 9. the title of our message this morning is Blind Beggar or Born Again Believer. And it's interesting, as we go through it, I had to, you know, as I go through the message multiple times, this section of scripture, it's easy to not remember what's taking place. Things are moving so fast in scripture. And if, as you look at it, we have to remember, Jesus has just called all his disciples. Jesus has just shown up on scene, man, in flesh, and he is shining the light in the darkness. But the darkness is not receiving it. And as this is all happening, Jesus is claiming that he is God. He says, I am. And he's done multiple things to show who he is as God. And we walk amongst Jesus as we walk, as we read and have devotions in this word. We get to walk next to him and see how he interacts with the Pharisees, how he interacts with the lost, with the saved, with the disciples. And we get to know who God is. And that's the coolest thing about this, about the word of God. And so just remember where we're at now. Some people believe we're, you know, this is, it's Jewish mostly, because at this time, you know, God is still focusing on the Jews in this section of scripture. And things are getting ready to be the focus of the Gentiles, which is us. But so right now, all these Jews, they've been caught up in this religion, and it was initially God's, he ordained it, he set it up. It was a covenant, the old covenant. But Jesus comes and he's revealing a new covenant. And he's not bringing, it's not something different. It's not that he's a new God, but he is making a better path that he's had in mind the whole time. It's his will. He knows the beginning, the end. He's the Alpha and the Omega. And as he is revealing the way to follow him to all people, some people struggle. My wife was a Mormon when I met her, right? But she knew Jesus, but they weren't teaching the word of God. So she did struggle. You know, she was struggling with things because she didn't have quite the right direction, even though she was saved. And so this word is how we connect to God. It's how we get to know him. It's how we know what is truth and what is not truth. And sometimes things that we have in our minds that we think is truth isn't truth, and those things have to be corrected. And we'll see that in the disciples' lives this morning, as then they pretty much started this culture of the Jewish religion. It was really cultivating into less about what the word was, because it was being manipulated as they were adding these rules and explaining and getting commentary to it. But also that they, hold on a second, I just lost my thought. Basically, people were spiritually blind, even though they had the word of God. And Jesus is exposing the truth. Right in front of them, they've had it, but he's showing them how to apply it, like, correctly. But all these false doctrines or wrong ways of thinking have been ingrained into their minds. And one of those things is that if you have a disease, or if you're sick, or you're suffering anyway, the reason why is because you are in sin, or because God has inflicted it upon you. Which is not truth, but you can find scriptures to form an argument on that. But what had happened is the Pharisees, they were more about what the culture was getting into. They were the ones that were, forming the worldview instead of scripture forming the worldview, right? And that happens today in Christianity, as man speaks, but man that's listening doesn't check the word and make sure what's being spoken is of the word, right? I'm not talking about the word. We are in the word. We're just going through the word together. And that's what we're doing this morning. And, and for us, we have a lot of things that are going to happen as we read this. We choose, do we believe it? Do I have faith? And no, this is the Word of God, that God is going to meet me this morning. He's going to speak to me through His Word. The same as Jesus is speaking to these people, and we're watching them as they have conversation, and they have a choice. Am I going to hang on to these things that I've been told that are true, that maybe could be wrong? Yeah, because you're human. How many things have you been wrong of before in your life? And then we see these, there's a division that takes place. And it's always a division because of the choice. You will choose to believe God or choose to not believe God. And so verse 1 here, just know that they know that Jesus is claiming to be the Messiah. They know, it's being known now who Jesus is saying that he is. It's no secret at this point. They're actually kicking people out of the synagogues if they confess Jesus as the Messiah. So that's the stage where we're at here, that the scene is going on. And there's a lot of mixed thoughts and what is truth and, you know, am I going to follow the crowd or am I going to follow the man, right? Am I going to be a fool for truth or am I going to go with the crowd? And so Jesus says he passed by and he saw a man who was blind from birth. So he passed, it doesn't say that he passed by not noticing this man, which is a blessing. Jesus passes by and it says, well, he saw a man who was blind from birth. Which is so encouraging, that even when we can't see, even if you don't see God, He sees you, and He's not going to pass you by, you know? He loves you. And so as He passes by, what happens is the disciples, they get stirred up and they have a question. And their question, we'll see in verse 2 here, is, the disciples speaking, don't get confused on that, it's the disciples right here that are saying this to Jesus. They say, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? And so you see the disciples are even saying that this is true, right? This is not true. It is not because of sin. We know that that is not what the Word of God says. And it's just cool to me that we see the disciples saying it here. If you read through it quickly, you might actually think, oh, that was the Pharisees speaking. But when you read it again and again, you're like, whoa, that was the disciples saying that. So the disciples, because sometimes I think we put them on a different level than the Pharisees and those that don't know Christ or the Gentiles, and the truth is we're all in the same boat. The truth is we all are learning and continuing to learn. And so who suffered? Or who sinned? Was it this man's parents, or was it the man himself? And the thing is, he was born blind. And as we look at this, like as we always do when we're in Scripture, we have to look at the physical aspect, and we also look at the spiritual aspect. What is Jesus doing here? As he is going to be ministering to this man that is blind, today he's ministering to us. That, yeah, maybe we see physically, but do we see spiritually? And he's also opening the eyes to the disciples and to those that are around spiritually. So there's always someone that has to be blamed for sin, right? That's what happens. And that's what the case is. Even when there's something bad in your own life, we always ask the question, why? Or, why did this happen to me? Or who did this? You know, why or who? And the truth is, it's because you don't have an understanding of the origin of this, everything. Why do bad things happen? It's not because God does it. It's not because you've sinned. I mean, you have sinned, and so have I. The disciples have sinned, and we'd all be diseased and blind if that's the case, right? The truth is, Adam and Eve sinned from the beginning. Sin was introduced into the world, and when that took place, it's for some reason this is so hard for people to grasp, that we live in a place that is full of brokenness and sin and suffering because of sin. It's because of where we live, not because of the God we serve. God doesn't do these. He's not causing these things. But God allows these things to happen. He could change things, yes. But for some reason, we always have to blame somebody, you know? So the disciples, they're like, is it because of his sin? Or is it because of his parents' sin? And by these guys opening their mouth and saying that, they're actually exposing their heart. And I'm not trying to beat up on the disciples. I'm just making an observation. That is, that Jesus sees this man. He's a beggar. He's blind. And he's walking by. And Jesus sees him. But how does Jesus see him? And then ask yourself, how do the disciples see him? Or do they even see the blind beggar? Because what comes out of their mouth is, who sinned, right? His parents? They want to know something that's doctrine. That has to do with theology, right? They're like, we're learning, we're studying, right? It reminds me, and I'm not trying to beat up on doctors either, but have you ever been in a hospital when you're sick and you're suffering, and the physician has a poor bedside manner? You're like, man, this guy is just rude, you know? Like, doesn't he know I'm like having a heart attack here, you know, or whatever? And that's what's happening here, and it's because we're human. I'm not trying to bag on them, but interns, sometimes they can do that because they're focused on learning. They're focused on knowledge. And right now the disciples are focused on learning. They're supposed to be. They're sponges, just like we are today, this morning. But the thing is that we have to remember that it's not about theological things. It's not about doctrinal things only. It's not even about just ministry. When we treat people poorly, or when we don't see people as people, the disciples don't see a blind man. They see a lesson, right? Just like one of the interns might see, heart, blood, and how can we, fix this heart? But not thinking, that's a person, Well, Jesus, he loves. And as we see how he responds, that's the appropriate reaction. But we know what the Bible says about our hearts. They're deceitfully wicked. And we also know that the Bible talks about our hearts telling on us, right? Whenever we open our mouths, the Bible says that out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. And so what that is saying is that where is your treasure? Where is your thoughts, your mind, your desires? Are they on things above? Is it spiritual things, or are you so caught up in the physical world that you don't see the spiritual world? Are you so caught up in things that are earthly treasures that, and we talked about this last week, it has to do with fruit. Last week or the week before. It has to do with fruit because what you abide in is what you're going to bear, right? If you abide in Christ, you're going to bear fruit. And if you're bearing fruit, it's good fruit if you're abiding in Christ. But if you're not abiding in Christ, then your fruit can turn out not to be so good. And as Christians, we go back and forth like this all the time. Not saying that, I mean, of course, you struggle, right? And just because I struggle doesn't mean I have bad fruit. Just because the disciples, in this moment, their heart was maybe hard and not in the right place, it's because they're human. And praise God that we get to see that, because we are the same as them. But it's here that we're able to learn from it. It's here that we're able to say, when I am doing ministry, I am trying to be serious about these things, but really it's all about the people. Like I said, the speakers, the building, if it all goes away, does it really matter? It really doesn't matter. It's all about the Word of God. It's all about the body of Christ. The patients are more than a clinical study. And the blind man is a man that's a beggar, and he's suffering. But the disciples didn't see that. Jesus says to the Pharisees, if you turn to Matthew chapter 12, verse 35, Matthew 12, 35. And so Jesus is speaking to the Pharisees. And he says, we'll just start at 33. He says, either make the tree good and its fruit good, or else make the tree bad and its fruit bad. For a tree is known by its fruit. And then he says, brood of vipers. I'm pretty sure that that term is a descriptive phrase of bad fruit. So Jesus is already determining their bad fruit pretty much. Brood of vipers, how can you, being evil, speak good things? So really, it's not about, it's about the heart. The heart is the root of the matter, right? The root of the matter. See that, how that works? It is the root of the matter, because where your heart is, that's what's going to come out of your mouth. Where your treasure is, that's what's exposed. When the wind blows and the tree shakes, and what falls off, right? What kind of fruit is it? When the mouth speaks, we see what's in the heart. And he says, for out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. And so, that's a good way for us to know, how am I doing? Well, what's coming out of my mouth, you know? And it's also a warning for you, you know, and me, for people that say one thing, but, because sometimes they'll say things, but then they do different things, and you'll notice whenever they say certain things that aren't love, you're like, wow, where'd that come from? That's not from God. You'll know what kind of fruit you're dealing with there. So what comes out of the mouth shows what is the treasure in your heart. In verse 3, this is what it says here, verse 3, chapter 8, or 9, verse 3. Jesus says, this is his answer to their question, neither this man nor his parents sinned, but that the works of God should be revealed in him. And so the works of God would be revealed in him. So when the afflicted, like I said, a lot of times they ask why and who, or we ask. When I'm afflicted, I do the same thing. When I lost my daughter, I said, why and who, whose fault? But there's never an answer. But when we move past asking how and what, or when we move past asking why and who, and we start asking how and what, you know, now that this has happened, forget about the who. It's happened, but because it's happened now, what are you going to do about it? Now, what are you going to do about it? How are you going to deal with it? Today, people, they still believe that if you're inflicted or afflicted, a lot of people still believe that it's because of sin, which blows my mind. I'm like, didn't you read Job? You know. But there is a lot of people like that still that believe that. And those people that believe that, they really make the afflicted out to be someone extra, like they're extra sinner, right? Because we all sin. So that means if you're in disease or sick or afflicted, that means you must be a special extra sinner, right? You're special. You're extra. Otherwise, God wouldn't have afflicted you. Man, that frustrates me when I see that. But I do agree, the afflicted are extra. They're extra special because of Psalms 34:18. What does it say in Psalms 34:18? That he is nigh to the brokenhearted. God is nigh to the brokenhearted. So they are extra special. Not extra special sinners, but they're extra special because God has allowed them to go through this, and he's going to use it in their life, whatever it might be. Some of the most afflicted people are the most blessed people. Have you ever noticed that? Some of the greatest afflicted lives are lived with the fullest abundant life, those that are afflicted. How in the world that way. Look at these pictures I wanted to show you up on the screen. There's three of them. And they're beautiful. I'm just blown away. God the Father uses evil things that have happened to you, that have happened to me, that have happened to everybody, people in general. He uses those things for good if we choose, right? It's now that I have this, or I'm dealing with this, it's not about the why. I know why. It's because we're sinners. I know why. It's because of the fall. It's because this isn't heaven. But it's about what? What am I going to do about it? Well, I can offer this up to God. I can offer my suffering up to Him and use it to glorify God. Did you see the three different pictures? Are those amazing? Do you know who painted those? Does anybody? A paraplegic painted those with a pen or a paintbrush in her mouth. Isn't that amazing? She loves Jesus. You know, all know probably Johnny Erickson taught it, right? She's amazing, man. But it's a good reminder that I watched a little bit of her testimony, and I was so encouraged, man, because I don't know how she could do that in my mind. I'm like, but at the same time, you don't know how you can deal with what you're dealing with. But when you get there, God's going to give you the grace that you need. And maybe He's going to glorify you or glorify Him by healing you. He might do that. He might choose to, you know, be that light in the darkness by healing you, but He might not heal you. He might choose a different route. So, oh man, it's so frustrating, right? There was a certain group of Pentecostals that Johnny was sharing about, that they had come to her right when she first experienced this, and she was paralyzed, you know, quadriplegic, and I think she was like 20. She was young. It was a diving accident. And they came to her and they said, man, you need to repent, you know, because if you repent, God will heal you, you know. And I can't imagine what she was dealing with, questioning at that moment. She was in the place of the why and the what. Why did this happen to me? God, why is this happening, Lord? Why did you, you know, looking for someone to blame. And then here they are, they're telling her it's your fault. You know, it's because you're the sinner. And but the truth is, it was sweet when she was talking about it. Because then the next thing they always say is they say, let us pray for you, you know. And she said she's heard that lots of times. And what she would start to say is, you know what, that's great that you want to pray for me. I'll accept prayer all the time. And she said, but will you pray for my wicked heart too? Will you pray for my anger that I struggle with? Will you pray for my doubt that I struggle with? Will you pray for me that I'll continue to have a desire to stay in the Word? You know, like she was talking, just, it was so cool. Because the thing is that we're all sinners, you know. And, for her, it's beyond. She even mentioned, you know, what does the Bible say? If your arm offends you or whatever, cut it off, right? She's like, she says, you know, she knows that's a metaphor. We know that's a metaphor. But that's the seriousness of it, is really the spiritual, the condition of your heart really matters more than anything. And I guarantee you, Johnny Erickson Tata has probably lived a way fuller life than most people. I mean, abundant life. Just, there's joy that comes from her that's amazing. You guys got to watch her testimony. It's so cool. But God didn't cause these things. God didn't cause the beggar, the blind beggar, to be blind. But because they have happened, God can use those for good in our lives. And sometimes He will heal you. Sometimes He won't. In verse 4, as we continue, verse 4 and 5, Jesus says, I must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. The night is coming when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. That's amazing. He just said he is the light, and he's speaking of a time frame of when there's day, and there will be no day, it will be dark. And I'm like, whoa, you're the actual source of that light. And he created all things. And so he says, I must work. And I love this because some people read this and take it out of context and they say, you got to work for your salvation type thing. But Jesus isn't talking about working for his salvation, right? That doesn't make sense. What he's saying here is that he has an opportunity to work, to glorify God. He has an opportunity, while it's day, to be a light in the darkness. Right now is the time when you can let your light shine in the darkness. But there will become a day when the day is over, when those that are left, that do not accept Christ, there will be no light. So we don't work to be saved, but because you are saved, you work to be the light. You're the light because you're saved. I'm not trying to be saved by the light. Has God put an urgency in your heart, or a calling, or something where you would say, I must. That's what I have. I say that. I'm like, I must teach the word. God's given me that. I must teach the word until he comes. Like, I'm going to teach the Bible because it's like Jeremiah, right? He's like complaining. I'm going to quit doing that. You know? But then what happens? He's got fire in his bones. He's like, I can't. He had to keep preaching, even though the whole period of time, not one person received him. Not one person did he see any good fruit. But God gave him that. He gave him that work. He used him to be a light. And God wants to use everything in you and everything in me to be a light. Everything that you do, we do it under the Lord. Just the way you are. You don't have to become somebody else, or when you're done dealing with this, my dad dealing with whatever he's dealing with today, and he's not able to be here. It'd be easy to get discouraged and be down and like, I have no purpose. I have no, why am I even here type thing, And I know a lot of people feel like that just from being at home, so long recently. But the truth is Johnny Erickson Tata had no arms and no legs. And look what God's done in her life. How many people have been saved through her testimony? And she's glorified God in a way that you would say is impossible. And it's because you can do all things with God. With him, it's not impossible. So God doesn't cause a sickness. The fall did it. And while it's day, while we still have time, we need to glorify God with our lives. And God's going to use you as you are. Maybe he'll heal you, maybe he won't. But maybe you'll be that light that'll bring somebody out of darkness. And they'll have an eternal change in their life. That is the greatest thing you can ever experience. So in verses 6 and 7, it says that when he had said these things, he spat on the ground, and he made clay with the saliva, and he anointed the eyes of the blind man with the clay. So Jesus spits in the ground, and he makes mud out of the ground with this clay, and he says to him, to the blind beggar, go wash in the pool of Siloam, which is translated sent. So go wash in the pool of Siloam. So he went and he washed, and then he came back seeing. So I love this because Jesus gave the blind beggar a choice. He said, you can believe. He's probably thinking, man, that's not, it's easy for us to do a simple task like go walk down to the pool and get in and wash. But I'm sure if it's a blind man, it would not be that, it's probably difficult walking through the crowds, getting, I don't even know how far he had to go, but he had to go, there was steps that you had to climb down to get to the pool. But you know what, this guy believed Jesus, but he had a choice. He could have said, whatever, you know, I'm gonna sit here and keep begging, you know. But he had a choice to believe or not believe. And isn't it true that what we believe determines our actions? What we believe determines our actions. So what he believes is going to determine the very next act that he does. And what does he do? He's going to go wash. He goes down and washes. And then he comes back and he can see. And I love this because not only does God provide us a way where we can be saved, or a way that we can, like this man, Jesus is giving him a way where he can go down. If he's just obedient and washes, he'll be healed. But not only does Jesus provide the way, but he also gives the man some motive. I love this because he knows who we are as human beings. Because I was thinking to myself, why in the world would he use clay, right? I mean, we all know that he doesn't want it to be where people are like, okay, he used this kind of clay and we're going to try and mimic that or whatever. But I was thinking this, even if you couldn't see, I'm pretty sure that mud in your eyes would be a great irritation like it would be for me or you, right? So Jesus is giving him a little encouragement. He's giving him some irritation. He's giving him truth, and he's saying, be obedient, but I'm going to help you be obedient. I'm going to put this clay in your eyes. You're going to choose to stay and not wash now. I just think that's so cool because that's what happens with us. Is Jesus convicts us. If you don't know Jesus and you can't see and you're lost and you're living in this world and he's calling out to you, not only is he calling out to you, not only has he provided a way to salvation by dying on the cross for your sin, but he convicts you. He causes an irritation in your heart. And he's drawing you and he's saying, come get life. You don't have to be a blind beggar. You can be a born again believer. You don't need to stay a blind beggar. And that's so encouraging to me that God helps us not only by making a way for salvation, but he leads us to salvation. And he gives us the very saving faith that we need for salvation. I'm sure there would be people watching as Jesus is putting mud in his eyes, and they're like, what is this guy doing? That's wrong. You come up and watch someone do that to a blind guy, that's pretty cruel. Spitting on him and putting dirt in his eyes, rubbing, that's like pretty offensive, right? I'm sure there was a lot of people that were going, man, what are you doing? That's offensive, you know? That's horrible. And it's funny because the gospel's offensive, right? The gospel is an irritant to many. But it's what will help them see. So preach it. Preach the gospel. Salome means sent. And God wants to send you and me to bring sight to the world, to the blind world. We've been sent to show the way, to wash away the clay. The world doesn't know, but we know the way, that they can wash away the clay of sin, and we can tell them with the water of the word. Look at Isaiah chapter 35. Isaiah 35, this is so amazing, it's prophetic. Isaiah 35, I was going to read just one verse and I decided now we're going to read the whole chapter. It's real short though. But this chapter is explaining that there will be a coming Messiah. And there's so many good things in here that if you were a Jew living in that day, if you read this and you knew this chapter, What an encouragement as you're watching Jesus fill these people, the blind, the crippled, the lame, the deaf. How do you not know this is the Messiah? Let's read and see what it says. Jesus is speaking of the future here for Israel. So yeah, he's speaking of Zion, of Israel, literally. But at the same time, he's speaking prophecies all the time. A lot of times it's a dual prophecy, and that's what this is here. He's also speaking of the coming Messiah. This is what happens when the Messiah comes. Verse chapter 35, verse 1. The wilderness and the wasteland shall be glad for them, and the desert shall rejoice and blossom as the rose. It shall blossom abundantly and rejoice, even with joy and singing. The glory of Lebanon shall be given to it, the excellence of Carmel and Sharon. They shall see the glory of the Lord, the excellency of our God. When they see Jesus walking amongst them, they're seeing his glory, the glory of God, the excellency of God. He says, strengthen the weak hands, make firm the feeble knees. Say to those who are fearful, those that are fearful hearted, be strong, do not fear. Behold, your God will come with vengeance. With the recompense of God, he will come and save you. Then the eyes of the blind will be opened, and the ears of the deaf shall be unstopped. This is what you're going to see when the Messiah comes. The lame will leap like a deer, and the tongue of the dumb sing. For water shall burst forth in the wilderness, and streams in the desert. The parched ground shall become a pool, and the thirsty land springs of water. Man, I could be speaking to somebody's soul right now, their spirit, parched, dry. In the habitation of jackals, where each lay, there shall be grass with reeds and rushes, and this is so amazing, a highway shall be there, and a road. Jesus made a way. And it shall be called the highway of holiness. They got it wrong in that song. It's not the highway of heaven. It's the highway of holiness. The unclean shall not pass over it. So there you go. If you're unclean, it's not going to work. You can't pass over it. But it shall be for others. Whoever walks the road, although a fool, shall not go astray. A fool to the world, right? That's what it's talking about. Are you willing to be a fool to the world? Because that's what sometimes it requires. The world is going to call you and me a fool when we follow Jesus. But on this road, it says in verse 9, no lion shall be there, nor shall any ravenous beast go up on it. It shall not be found there. But the redeemed shall walk there. And the ransomed of the Lord shall return and come to Zion with singing, with everlasting joy on their heads. They shall attain joy and gladness and sorrow, and singing shall flee away. So the greatest miracle that this blind beggar experienced wasn't to see physically, but to become born again. He's become a born again believer. That's the spiritual things that God is doing. That's the greatest miracle that's taken place. Though it is great that you can see. But the Messiah has come. And they're watching him. We're reading of God on earth and seeing his glory right just laid out in front of us as he interacts with mankind. It says in verse 8, therefore, the neighbors and those who previously had seen that he was blind, they said, is this not the one who sat out and begged? And someone said, this is he. But others said, he is like him. And he said, no, I am he. So in other words, they're arguing back and forth in front of him about whether or not this is the same man that was born from birth that's been blind. This guy has never seen. When you realize that, when you think that's got to be different than if you've seen and then went blind, imagine if you've never seen anything and someone's trying to explain to you what things are. You don't even know what color it is. I can't even grasp that. But that's exactly how it is for the non-believer. They have no idea what they're missing in Christ, right? They can't see even a glimpse of it. But Jesus wants to heal them and give them spiritual light. Well, the man himself wins the argument. He has to step up and say, I'm the beggar, He says, I was the beggar, I am the beggar, and I don't have a twin brother, It's like, the God, there's not someone else that you're seeing here. That was me. People will go so far to deny what's going to require them to acknowledge God. And that's what's happening. These guys don't want to acknowledge God, so they'll come up with anything. Well, maybe he's got a twin brother, But what's so cool is that this guy is persistent about what God has done and who he is. He doesn't let the world or let them tell him who he is. He's like, no, I can see. I was a blind beggar, but now I'm a born-again believer. The blind man, his progression is amazing as we watch. Look in verse 11. It says, he answered and said, amen. Or verse 10 first. Therefore they said to him, how were your eyes opened? So now that they know that he's him, they're going to, okay, well, how were you healed? How were your eyes opened? And he answers them and says, a man called Jesus made clay and anointed my eyes and said to me, go to the pool of Siloam and wash. And I love that because this guy doesn't know the scripture, right? This guy's blind. He knows maybe what people have told him. But this guy doesn't even know who Jesus is or who he was. He's like, this man, all I know is a man called Jesus. That's all I know. That's all he knew. He didn't know what Jesus looked like. Because remember, Jesus told him to go to the pool. And then when he came back, he could see, but Jesus wasn't there, So he didn't see Jesus afterwards yet. So he doesn't even know what Jesus looks like. But what he does know, he knows his name and he knows that he healed him. He knows that now he can see. And look at his testimony. It's nothing special. All he does is explain. They're not satisfied with Jesus the Messiah put clay in my eyes and now I see. I was blind and now I see. I was a blind beggar. Now I'm a born again believer. Like, they can't compute that. They want to find a different answer. They're looking for something logical, like, okay, well then, how do you break that down logically? And what's so amazing is that whatever you do know about God, that's what you share. So what do you know about God? Share what you know. Hopefully you know more than the blind man. Hopefully, if you're in the same with him, hopefully it's because you're a new believer. Not that you've been walking around as a believer and not growing and learning. But it's not necessarily what you know, it's who you know. If you know a lot about Scripture, that's awesome. If you know a lot about who Jesus is, awesome. But don't let Christianity be all about doctrine. Remember, it's not all about the logistics of ministry, it's all about the people. So yeah, know Jesus, know doctrine, serve in ministry, but love people. Remember, it's all about people. That's why Jesus came, that's why Jesus died. God is love. So when I went and washed, I received sight. And then they said to him, where is he? And he said, I do not know. How refreshing is that? These guys would never say, you'd never hear a Pharisee say, I don't know. They know everything. But it's so cool because it's okay to say, I don't know. I don't know. All I know is that I was blind and now I see. I want to tell you about that, you know? And I don't, you know, I can just tell you who I was and who I am now. And I don't, you know, people are going to want to get into the details. Okay, so how close did the fly to the ceiling before it flipped over to land? I don't care. Like, that doesn't make any, like, I don't know, like, about salvation. It doesn't matter. All I know is I couldn't see and now I can. And so if you don't know Jesus, the day is not going to last forever. Soon Jesus will return and take his bride, and it's going to be night. And you can't work in night. You can't work in the darkness. You can't. There is no association with Jesus right now if you don't know him, because you're blind on the earth. But the time will come when there will be only darkness. This blind man didn't know anything, but he was still willing to listen and obey. And ultimately, because of that, he received sight. If you're not saved, you need to come to Jesus and wash away the clay, the sin that's in your life, that's blinding you. God hasn't caused that in your life. Whatever it is, whatever affliction. But the one affliction that you have, that we all have, is sin, and Jesus has taken care of that. And he may heal you of your physical affliction, he may not. But he wants to touch your spiritual eyes and give you life. Abundant life, not just when you die, but for right now. Your sin can be forgiven, and your spiritual blindness will be no more. Everything that the blind man had before, think about this, all that he had was when he sat there begging. The only thing he had was what he received from the world. That's it. When someone walked by and said, here you go, let me give you some advice. Let me give you some money. Whatever they gave him, all that he had was from the world. But when he obeyed Jesus, his whole life changed. The world has nothing to offer you if you don't know Christ. You're just a blind beggar. That's true spiritually. In a sense, you're a blind beggar. Don't stay a blind beggar. Receive from Jesus Christ and become a born-again believer. If you don't know Jesus, that's the call today, is to salvation. Have your eyes open. And maybe you're a believer and you've just been walking with your eyes closed. You don't have your eyes on things above, allowing your heart to get caught up in other things, distracted. Man, it's so simple. It's two things, right? Love the Lord your God with all your heart, your mind, and your strength. Love your neighbor as yourself. We'll talk about the neighbors next week. Or no, we just talk about the neighbors, huh? Yeah, verse 8. The neighbors. Love your neighbor. Do those things. You might feel like you don't have much to do right now, but look at Johnny Erickson Thomas. She didn't have any arms or legs, and she probably felt like she couldn't do anything. Man, she's touched the world, you know? She's glorified God mightily. God wants to use you, if you're a believer, to be alive. And if you don't know him, man, he's made the way, the highway to holiness. All you gotta do is believe him, receive from him, be obedient, confess your sin, and ask him into your life. Ask him to be the Lord of your life. If you believe in your heart that God rose Jesus from the dead, and you confess with your mouth, make him the Lord of your life. Confess with your mouth, Lord Jesus, and you will be saved. Because with the heart, you believe, and when you believe, you're righteous. But with the mouth, mouth speaks unto salvation. Because what's in your heart? What's your treasure? Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So I just pray for you today, if you don't know Christ, go wash. Go to Jesus. Dear Lord, we love you, we praise you. God, I thank you so much that you've given us life. God, I know there's a lot of people today that are struggling with physical illnesses and ailments, or struggling with spiritual warfare, or emotional attacks, God, mental distress. And they might be asking, why and who? There has to be someone to blame. Well, there is. That me, right? No. It's us, God. We're sinners, every one of us. And the fall has caused this earth to be destroyed. There was no death, only life. There was no suffering, only joy. There was no crying or tears. Just smiles, God, that's all there was. But now, Lord, you made a way, and you were creating a place for us to have all of that again, God. All we have to do is believe and trust you. And God, while we're here, while it's still day, Lord, we just want to glorify you in everything that we do. God, help us to glorify you in everything, God. Whether it's our weakness, whether it's something that you've given us. Either way, they're both gifts, God. Johnny Erickson's Hada has an amazing gift, Lord. You've given her a gift in her quadriplegia, Lord. By making her, you didn't make her that, but by her becoming that, that accident taking place, God, that's a gift that she's used in her life to glorify you, Lord. I pray you help those people move, God, from being stuck at the why and the who, that they would say, okay, now what? Or how? How am I going to do this? How am I going to glorify God? We love you, Lord. We praise you, God. I pray for the lost, Lord. I pray for those that are hurting. We praise you, Father. In Jesus' name, everyone said, amen.